Hello guys again. Before we dive into our application, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. So I'm a part-time backend developer right now. Before that, I was a front-end developer 2.5 years with Angular. So I'm very familiar with this framework, and I'll be very glad if I can help you understand a little bit of it. So let's get started. Here I'm going to create another folder. So this folder is going to be the name of my application. So let's say that I'm going to make a directory which is in Catstagram. Okay, after I've created this, I'm going to get into this, but before that I want to show you something very specific here. So I'm going to say Angular CLI. Angular CLI is a very powerful tool that can allow you to do a lot of commands which can create easily Angular components and services. So here, as you can see, we have this npm install -g, which means globally Angular CLI. I want you to pay attention here, because here we have this slash. If you see this configuration, let's say Angular dash CLI, this is the older version, so you need this new version of the CLI in order everything to work properly. Okay, so now because I have already done that, you just need to run this command. After this, we're going to create our project. Okay, so now I'm going to say ng new. This is for making a new project in Angular through the CLI. So now I'm going to name my project, which will be Catstagram. And I'm waiting. So the first thing here is that it's going to ask me if I want to include Angular routing. Of course I will, because here we're going to have a logic which should be with routing, so yes. And because this is a basic application, I'm going to use CSS, and here I just say enter. And right now I'm waiting in order my project to be created. After the project is created, I'm going to show you the structure of this project. It's very interesting and very easy to use once you get the basic idea how to use Angular at all. Okay, so our app is created successfully. That's cool. By the way, be aware of that this is a live coding session, so if an error appears, I'm going to search it in Google with you, so you're going to see the whole process of developing this kind of apps. Okay, so now, once we have created our app, we can go to the directory and see a bunch of files here. Okay, so the main thing here is to look in this source folder. I'm using Visual Studio Code here. And I'm going to open the file through this. So I have to find my project in the first place. And I'm going to open this source folder. Okay, so now, as you can see here, we have a folder called app. If we go into this folder, we can see that here Angular has created for us a so-called module TS file. TS file is because Angular is using TypeScript. So the older version, which was the first version of Angular called AngularJS, is using JavaScript, plain JavaScript. But here, from Angular 2 Plus, we're using TypeScript. And there's a lot of cool features that I'm sure you're going to love. So here, we have this so-called module, and of course we have here a module routing, which is very important for our application, but for now we are not going to use it. So we have set up our project. It's so easy to use this CLI tool, so we can continue doing our logic right now. Okay, our first task here is to do the login. So how we can achieve that? In Angular, everything is a class. Class with some kind of decorator. So now I'm going to use the tool, and I'm going to show you how you can create a component. This is the basic thing in Angular. You should use always components, and as small the components are, better. So now I'm going to create a component, and I'm going to enter in this folder. So right now I'm going to see cd catstagram, and again cd catstagram no, CD source. Yeah, source. Okay, CD app. Okay, now I'm here, and here I'm going to use the CLI too. See now how I'm going to do that. NG, G, which means generate, stands for generate. After that, I'm going to use C, which means component. NG generate component, and now I'm going to write the name of my component. Because my component is responsible for the login logic, I'm going to name it login. Okay, so I'm going to say login here. Okay, we have created our component. A couple of things to notify here. So see how we have created an HTML file, a spec.ts file, which is for testing, we are not going to use that. And here we have TypeScript and CSS. And one important thing here to notice is that we have this line, which says that Angular has updated for us the model part, which is this. Basically, if we go to appmodel.ts, we can see here that we have created our login component, we have imported it automatically, and we have registered in the declaration array. So basically in Angular you have three or four very important things in the ng model decorators. So the first thing is declaration, where you can where you can define, let's say, components, pipes, directives, and so on. Here we have imports array, which is responsible for importing modules, as you can see here, browser model, app routing model, and so on. We have provider array, which is responsible for our services. I'm going to show you how we can create a service and why we should do that. And of course, for the bootstrapping, you can see here that the Angular starts from our app component. And our app component, how you can see the bootstrapping. So if you go to this index.html page, you can see that here we have just one body. And here we have something very interesting. So if you see here app-root, that means that is a selector of an HTML, which brings a component logic, CSS logic, and HTML logic. If we start looking to our components here in app.component.ts, we can see that here we have this selector, okay? I'm going to explain a little bit of everything. So now I just want you to see how the Angular is starting, okay? So right now we're bringing this logic here for AppRoot. And if you go to appcomponent.html, you can see a lot of styles here and a lot of HTML written. How we can see that our Angular application is working properly? Well, we can go to the console and say ng-serve. If we say ng-serve, it's going to build the application, and now we can go to localhost 4200. Okay, so now we have here this screen, which allows you to understand that we have a working application right now. Okay, so now I'm going to delete everything in this file, and I'm going to say just a simple h1 tag which says hello, just to see if everything is working correctly. By the way, one thing is very cool for Angular, and that's when I save this, my server is going to reload, and if I go to the page without reloading, I'm going to see my result. Okay, so now we have created the login component, and what we are going to do now? Well, I'm going to use Bootstrap CDN, so I'm going to say Bootstrap 4, and as you can see here, we have this framework which allows us to use a bunch of CSS classes and grid system, which is very, I don't know, let's say useful to build a simple application. Of course, if you want some cool design, you can build your own CSS classes, because I don't think that the Bootstrap classes are good enough for smoothly things. Okay, so let's get started. Here we can see that we should paste this link to the Bootstrap CDN in our HTML. So if I copy that, be notified that this framework is a single page application, creating a single page application. So we are going to have just one body and just one head, of course. So if I go to index.html, here's the place I can put my link from Bootstrap. Okay, so now if I save, you're going to see a little bit different result here. That means Bootstrap is working, and Bootstrap classes are working too. Okay, so now here from Bootstrap, I can take a couple of things like Popper.js, jQuery, and excuse me, and Bootstrap Min.js. If I get these things, I'm able to use a lot of features in Bootstrap, like sliders and so on. So if I go back here, I'm going to put the scripts just before the closing body tag. Okay, so now once we have this, we can continue building our logic. So the first thing here is to have a form which allows us to put our data, let's say username and password. Okay, so now I'm going to use contents here, or maybe components. I'm going to use components from Bootstrap, and I'm going to say form. If I say form here, I'm going to see that Bootstrap allows me to use a lot of designs for forms. As you can see here, there are a bunch of useful things like multiple selects, drop downs, and so on. So I right now I need just a simple form with the email address and password. Maybe here we're going to rename that let's say, I don't know, username, or what backend is expecting from us. So I'm going to copy that and I'm going to paste that in our HTML component. So right now I'm going to place that, and if I say that, save that, you're going to see that here our application still say hello. So that's not cool. We want to see this form, right? But here's the thing, we don't have routing right now. So right now the main thing I should do is to call this selector for the login, and this selector is going to bring the CSS, the HTML, and the TypeScript of the component which brings the selector, right? So right now I'm going to see what is the selector here. You're going to see that everything starts with up. I recommend you to keep this because a lot of crashes can appear. So up dash whatever it is okay for Angular. So right now I'm going to select this and say that I want to bring it here from my component. So I'm going to make it like an opening tag and a closing tag. And if I say that, you can see that we have a form here. So of course this form is a little bit ugly, you can say that. So I'm going to bring another Bootstrap classes here, which are for the grid system. So right now I'm going to say div with class. This is an HTML, you can see it's very cool. You can check it out. Okay, so now right now I'm going to bring container. And inside this div with class container, I want another div with class row. And after that, I want to paste my app login here. Okay, so if I go back, you can see here that I have a little bit different result, but that's not the good practice right now to do it like so. So I'm going to use container fluid to a little bit more of width, to have a little bit more of width. Okay, so if I refresh that, you can see that the result is also the same. Okay, so because this is a live coding, I'm going to do that. I'm going to delete that and I'm going to make it work in this form. So I'm going to say div with class container, and again I'm going to use div with class row, and inside this I want div with class col lg, which means large, 12. Okay, so here I'm going to put this. If you're interested in that Bootstrap grid system, you can check it out in Bootstrap. Basically what Bootstrap says to us, if you have a page, I can divide it in 12 pieces. So I can make 12 columns here. If you want, I can divide it in two. So column which is 6 and another column which is 6. Okay, I can divide it in 4 pieces, which means I have 3, and here I have 3. So I have 3, 3, 3, and 3, which makes 12 again. I can divide it, let's say 2. So I'm going to have 2, 2, 2. Okay, you get the logic, right? So I'm going to say that I have this column which is 12, but maybe I'm going to experiment a little bit and I'm going to say that it is 4. Okay, so right now I'm going to say another class, another div with class col lg, let's say 4, and the same thing I'm going to paste, I'm going to paste after this. So if I again say here up login and save, you can see that my form right now is in the middle of the screen. Why? Because let's say here we have this container, right? And this container is fluid, so it's a little bit like so. And here we have a column which is 4, here we have a column which is 4, and here we have another column which is 4. Okay, so right now I'm going to delete a couple of things that we are not going to use right now, and this will be this form check here. And of course I'm going to rename this, because it's not going to be email address, it's going to be username. Here we have to say that it's going to be a text field, and here we can remove this ID and a good script. Okay, so right now we don't need this small label, and of course we have password here with input password, and we have a submit button. If we go, we can check the result. It looks okay. So if I go to the CSS, I can write CSS, which is only for this class. Here are options that can be changed, but by default, this CSS is only for this HTML. So right now I can say something like form, and here I can write, let's say, border 1 pixel solid gray. Okay, another thing will be padding. Let's say top and down 10% and left and right 15%. Okay, let's see what is the result right now. Okay, we have a basic form right now, and maybe we can put our form a little bit down. Okay, so I'm going to say something like margin top 20%. And of course, if you want to do your form a little bit better, you can do something like this. You can see that here we have the column, and here we have the another column, and here we have the container. Here's the problem. We have this container divided by 3 pieces for the columns. If we make our container fluid here, you can see that our form will be a little bit bigger. Okay? Okay. So, right now we have our login form. Of course, we can add text which says to the user, please log in, and so on. But for now, we have more interesting things to do. So the first interesting thing to do is to make our HTML and our TypeScript to talk to each other, you know? And what is the solution here? Well, I'm really interested in reactive forms. So there are two approaches in an Angular you can use building forms. The first approach is template-driven form, which is very boring for me and I'm not going to show you. You can research it in Google. The second thing that I'm going to use is reactive forms module, which is very interesting. So everything in Angular is the same. You should register a module, you should register the package after that, and import it in the component you want to use it, and of course use it. So the first step here is to register our reactive forms module. So see, here I'm writing reactive forms module. Okay, but now I have to import it. If you don't know where a reactive forms module is, you can always research it in Google. It's very easy to find a solution. But because I'm knowing it, because I have done this like many times before, I know where it is. So here, the reactive forms module is from Angular at angular:/http. Angular slash forms. Okay, so we're done here in the model, and we're going to import that in our component. Here we're not going to import the module, but we're going to import the, let's say, this in the class we need. So I'm going to say import reactive forms. And here I'm going to say from angular/forms. I misspelled something, so I'm going to say reactive . Okay, so if I don't remember something, I'm going and say reactive forms import in component. It's essential to see that here is Angular, and I'm going to search through the Angular documentation. So we have the model.js, and the second step is to import form control. Okay, so here I'm going to import form control, but why? So the first step here, of course, is to define a variable. So form control. Okay, so here, why I need this variable? So here I'm going to use that variable like login form. That's the name. Okay, so this login form is going to be of type form control. More information you can find on Angular documentation, so don't worry. Here I'm going to use a dependency injection for my form builder, and I'm going to use a class that can build a form. Okay, so now I'm going to say private FB of type form builder. Okay, once I have done that, I can go into the constructor, because the constructor is the first thing that is invoked after the component is initialized. The second thing is this ng-onInit method, which is right now a little bit strange, but we're going to use it. And here I can say, okay, so this dot login form is equal to this dot form builder dot group. Okay, and now I can use that with my properties. Here I'm going to need a username and password. Okay, so I'm going to write this right now. I need form group here. Yes. Okay, so now I'm going to say username. In this username, here's the interesting part, by the way. Here I can have an array of arguments, so of elements. So the first element is the default value of this. I'm going to say it's empty. The second is another array of validators. I'm going to show you how you can do that. And the third element here is another array of async validators. So today we're going to do just simple validators of the form. Okay, so right now I'm going to delete just for now that and add the second property, which will be password. Okay, we have done this, but how we can bind everything work together? So the first step here is to notify the HTML that there is a form, and we can bind this HTML to this form. So I'm going to this HTML, and where is the form tag? I'm going to write form group. Okay, and here I'm going to bind to my form. So my form in the code is called login form. Okay, so I'm going to put this login form here. And here's another cool thing from Angular. You can bind an event which is called for this form ng-submit. And you can say that if something is submitted, you want to go to a function. So I'm going to say login. This function is not created, but I'm going to create it just in a second. So I'm going here in the class and I'm saying that I have this login function. I'm going to console log just to show you that it is working. Okay, so if I save that, I can go here, and every time I'm going to use this console. Okay, so right now I'm going to submit. Okay, it's clicked. So the main issue here is how to take these input values. Well, it's very easy with Reactive Forms module. I just have to say to the input a form control name attribute and bind it to the name of my form control attribute here. So here is username, and I'm going to say form control name username. See the logic? I have a login form, which is form group, and this form group has form control name, which is username. Okay, and the same thing will apply here, basically, but for password. Okay, so now I'm going to log something very interesting. Because I have of type form group, I have IntelliSense, and here I can say this dot login form dot, and as you can see here, I have a lot of properties and function for this form group. So I'm going to use value, which is property here, and I'm going to see if I write something like test here and submit that, you can see that I have this object, and this object is ready to go to the backend. Okay, so we have finished this part for the HTML and CSS, but here we have another interesting task. Okay, so we have done the login so far, just the HTML and the reactive forms part, and here I'm going to do the register part, which is very similar, because on register I have to have form again, which will be with username, email and password, and I have to build a reactive form, and this reactive form I have to bind to the HTML, and after that we're going to make a services which can call our backend and receive results. Okay, so now I'm going to the second step, which is to create. I'm going to open a console from here. I'm going to create another component. Do you remember how it's done? Okay, ngGC register. I'm waiting, and as you can see here, again, our app module is updated, and here we have our register component. Okay, so the same approach can be applied here. So I'm going to just copy paste this and put it here, and right now I'm going to create again this reactive form because it's very useful. Okay, I'm going to say register form of type form group. What have I done? Okay, register form of type form group. Okay, I have to add that. Our import is working correctly. So now I have to inject private LV of type form builder. Okay, and now in the constructor I have to say this dot register form is equal to this dot form builder dot group, and again I have to specify my properties here. So the first will be username, and again for now I'm going to leave it like so. After that I have to say password, and after that I have to say between them, I believe, doesn't matter, but I want to keep it simple. Okay, so email will be here. Okay, so I've just created this, and now I have to bind it to HTML, but I believe that you know already know that. So if I go, I have to copy the name of my variable in the code. So it's really important not to leave this login form here, because in this component, in this TypeScript, I don't have login form, I have register form. So I want to bind to my variable register form. And here I'm not going to have login function, I'm going to have register. So I'm just going to rename that and create another function which is called register. And here again, as you can see, I can say console dot log, and here I can say this dot register form dot value. Okay, so let me test that. How can I test that? Well, here I have to invoke a deselector which is not app login but app register. App register. We're going to resolve this issue, don't worry, we're not going to select every time the component. So here we have, as you can see, again username and password, because we haven't done that in the HTML for the third property, which will going to be email. So if I go here, I can put this HTML and say that it is going to be for the email part. So here I'm going to say this will be an email, and form control name will be email. Okay, so as you can see here, we are again, we don't have again CSS. So another thing is to copy that from here and paste it in this CSS, but it's not very useful. Why? I can make here in global style, if I want all of my forms to look like this, I can make this in global style.css, where I can specify every element what CSS should be applied to it. Okay, so let me try that. If I don't specify the HTML here, so I'm cutting that from here and I'm pasting it here and I'm saving that, you can see that the HTML is applied. Okay, so if you have global styles that should be applied everywhere on your application, please use that. Basically, you can use, of course, CSS variables. It's not hard to use CSS variables. You have to define them and then use it with var function. It's not that hard at all. I'm recommending doing this because at some point, someone will come to you and say, okay, I want everything that is blue on the side to be green. And you're like, okay, I have to do that. And because you have used variables, it's going to be like 5-minute changes. If you haven't, it's going to be a day. So use variables. Okay, so now we have this, and here again we have this submit. Okay, so I'm going to do another thing. I'm going to rename the buttons. Here it's going to be register, And in the login, it's going to be login. Okay, so a simple change, but better UI and UX. Okay, so now, after we have this, we can do a little bit of validations, okay? It's very important for us to have validations on our forms, because if we don't have this, our user won't be notified what is happening right now and what is wrong and why the application does not work. Okay, so now I'm going to say that here, first on login, I'm going to invoke that here. I'm going to remove app register and say app login. Okay, save that, go here and say something like, I want the username to be at least 3 letters and the password to be at least, I don't know, we should ask a value, but here we should say something like 8 characters. I don't know, we should specify the password later. Okay, let me show you how to create the basic error validation. So here I have set that you have another array, which is validators. If you use that, you can notice that it's important from Angular forms. You can use a couple of things here. Let's say that we want this field to be required. So I have to say validators.required. Okay, the password is required too. So I'm going to say validators.required. And right now I have to do the validation in my HTML. So basically the validation is another div, which, let's say this div will be, this is a Bootstrap class called alert.alertDanger. Okay, so here I'm going to say this field is required. Okay, so, but if I go to my application right now, you can see this field is here, it's popped up already. User hasn't done anything and he has already an error, which is not a good user experience. So right now we have to think how we can make that pop up when it is required but skipped. So let's say that if I click here, but I say tap, and after that the field should be appear here that this field is required. Okay, how we can achieve that? Here we have something like structural directives in Angular, which is basically writing for loops and ifs in the HTML. So a structural directive is very important and it is marked with this asterisk. So if you write this without it, it's not going to work. So I'm going to say ng if, and here we can think of a solution for our problem. So right now we know here that we have this form. If I log this form, by the way, you can see that we have a lot of controllers. I'm going to do that. I'm going to log the form when it's created in order to see what is happening here. I'm going to paste that and see here that when I refresh it, I have a form. Here, see, I have form group. If I expand this, you can see that here I have a lot of things, which is basically known from HTML CSS. I have parrot, invalid, valid, disable, enable, dirty, untouched, update on, root, validators. I have controls, which is basically my controls here. And each of my control has this username and password. Okay, so I'm going to show you a very cool thing in Angular. We can make getters from the form. So I'm going to say get username. And this get username function will return our control for the username of the form. So right now, I'm going to say something like return this dot login form dot get basically username. Of course, the very same thing I can do for the password. So I'm going to say get password here. And I'm going to say that I want this login form, oops, dot get my control, which is code password. Okay, let me show you what is done. So here we have controls, which, as you can see here, we have this, with get we can achieve these controls to be touched, okay? So here we have validators, async touched, very important thing that we have touched here. And we have errors, And as you can see here, we have something which is called errors. And this errors, by the way, by default, if we don't have any validators, this errors is equal to no. It's very important to remember that, because I'm going to show you how we can deal with this no object. Okay, so we have this errors, and after that we have required true. Okay, so this is the error which appears for the username field. How cool is that? Okay, so if I go here in the HTML, I can call my getter, which is basically username dot errors dot required, and here if the required is true, I can pop up this message. But what's the problem here? That here we can see it is invalid, yeah, because it's not full. If I start writing something, I'm going to see a lot of things here. So here I cannot read property required of no. Very interesting thing. So here what is happening right now? I'm going to log that in order to see it in every step, because this is very important. I'm going to say console log, and here I'm going to log every time this controller. Okay, so now as you can see here we have form control, which form control is our field. Here when we have typed A, that means the validator errors, there's no validator errors. Okay, so because the field is required, we have one character, it's okay right now, and here we have errors no. But what's the problem? We are trying here to say errors dot required, and what is the issue here? It says required of no. I cannot get property required of no. The solution is to put this question mark. If there is any in these errors, try to see for required. If I say that, you can see here that I have this feature. When I delete that and it's empty, it's going to pop up. When I tap something, it's going to disappear. But right now we have a very interesting question. Right now this is for when user enters the screen, this is here, which is not okay. So what's the logic? If we see the form control, we can see that here we have another property which can be very, very useful. Let's say here that we have this kind of properties, and we can say, let me see that. I don't see it. I'm looking for touch. Oh, okay, it's here. Touch, false. Before the user has touched this, I don't want to show the error, okay? So I'm going to write that exactly in my if. So right now I'm going to say username dot touched. If it's touched and at the same time this is there is an error for the required label and attribute, I'm going to display this thing here. So you can notice that here I don't have this. If I skip, it appears, and if I type something, it disappears. So the same thing basically we're going to do for the password field. Okay, I'm going to put that here, and I'm going to use my getter, but for password. Okay, and I'm going to say password.touch and password.errors question mark dot required. Okay, so now if I go here, you can see that if I tap and tap again, there are two validation errors. If I tap something here, there are none. Okay, so right now we should do something similar for our register form. So I'm going to do that, of course, here. Here I'm going to define three getters, as you can imagine, for the username, for the email, and for the password. Okay, been there, done that. Okay, so I'm going to do something like return this dot register form dot get, of course, and here I want to get the username controller. Okay, so after that I'm going to do the same thing but for the email, and the third getter will be for the password. Okay, so I'm going to make the same logic here with these required fields, but of course first I have to specify that there are indeed required. So I'm going to say validators.required on every field. And here we have validators.required. Okay, so now I'm going to use the very same logic here for the fields. Oh, what's that? Okay. And the last one will be here. So here I'm going to use, but it's not going to be for the password though, it's going to be for the username. And here it's going to be for password, I believe. Yeah, it is. No, it is for the email. And the third one will be for the password. If I go and of course call app.register just to see that everything is working correctly, I'm going to skip fields. There, okay. If I type something here, oh, why this is not working? Ah, it is working. Okay. So, no, this is not working. Why? Because if you take a closer look here, you can see that here we have password.touch and password.errors, which is cool. We have username.touch, username.errors, which is cool. But here, this copy-paste development is very dangerous, because here we have username.touch, password.errors. That's not good. We have to say username, username. Here it has to be email, and email for the bot, because we are validating just one control. And here we have password and password. So if I go again here, we can notice that here, if I type something here, it disappears, and here it disappears. Okay, now it is working properly. So the second step here is to call the backend. But before that, we have one additional step in Angular, which is to make a service. The service will be responsible for making an HTTP request in this part of the application. After that, I'm going to show you how you can make interceptors in order, let's say, to append authorization token or to intercept for errors or something like that. But for now, we're going to see the role of the service just making an HTTP queries, not queries, but requests. Okay, so right now I'm going to say in my Angular application something like I want to make a directory which is called services. In this directory, I'm going to say cd services, and here I'm going to say ng angular generate what? Generate cs, which stands for service, and I'm going to create my service. So basically, this service will be responsible for register and login of the user and getting and saving token. So I'm going to create a basic service which will be called out service, which stands for authentication service. So right now I'm going to say just out. Don't say service here, because Angular makes again a suffix which is service, and it's going to be authentication service service, which doesn't make any sense. So right now I'm going to say just out. And if we see here something very interesting, if you notice here we have app services, authentication service, pack and TS, but our app model is not updated. So you have to go manually to app model for the services and go to this providers array and say the name of your class. Basically the name of your class, of course, will be, we can see here, out service. Okay, so we are going to do that, and in models we are going to say authentication service, and from out import we're going to import that from services out.service. Okay, so now we have the service, and what have to do we next? Okay, so next we are going to do our HTTP request. So basically I'm going to go to out service and say that I'm going to need the module for this request. The module in Angular is called HTTP client module. So I'm going to say in app.module.ts, I'm going to register another module which is called HTTP client module. In previous version of Angular, I think it was 4 and 2, there was a module called just HTTP module. Here is from version 4 plus, I believe, that here we can use HTTP client module. It's mandatory because it's not going to work otherwise. So right now I'm going to say HTTP client module, and I'm going to import that. I don't know why my auto import today works whenever she wants. Okay, so now I'm going to say from is Angular common slash HTTP. Okay, so this is the right package. And now I'm going to go to service and import another thing which is very useful here, which is called HTTP client, not module. I'm not going to import module in my service. Okay, so right now I'm going to save from the very same spot. So at Angular slash common slash HTTP. Now, how can I use that? So I have to inject in my constructor private HTTP of type HTTP client, an object. I can use that. Let's say I'm going to create a login function, and this login function is going to do this.http.post. What? Well, I have to specify here as the first parameter an URL, and after that I have to specify the payload I want to send to the backend. So the payload we will be specified here as a parameter. And when I call this function, I'm going to give an argument of this data, okay? So here I want to return the result of this. Very interesting, in Angular, you can, of course, make type hints with this TypeScript. And I can say that here I'm returning observable. Basically, the observable, it's not like a promise, but if you're familiar with the concept, you know that there are asynchronous tasks that should be done. Let's say that we want to make a GET or POST request to our server, and the code continue executing, and when the data is there, we can render it to the HTML. Basically the same thing is here, but observables are very complex objects, and we have cold observables, hot observables, but we're not going to talk right now about that. So I have observable of type, let's say, any for now, and here I have to say my URL. So very cool feature in Angular is this here, which is this folder called environments. In environments folder, you can see that here you have environment.ts and environment.pro.ts. When you build your project for production, you can going to use the URL for the backend, which is for the production. But when you use Angular for testing purposes, you don't have to switch between URLs. You have to specify this in environment.ts, where the production is false, and you're going to query the backend on the staging server or the backend which is responsible for just testing purposes and building features, which is very cool. So right now I'm going to specify another variable, which will be API URL. Just in a minute we're going to specify what the API URL will be, and here I'm going to make something very interesting. Here, as you can see, we export in this environment, yes, we export this constant code environment, so I can import this in my service and use it. So right now I'm going to do exactly this. I'm going to say that I want to import this variable here, which is called environment, in my service, and I have to specify from where. So I'm going to see a relative path, which is here environments dot environment. Okay, so right now we are going to use this variable. Here I can specify a path. Let's say that we have private login path. It's not my mandatory here, but just to see the logic here, I'm going to have a login path which will be equal to the environment.api URL, which will be the domain name of our application, and after that I can say, let's say login, and that will be my path. And here I can use this variable, let's say this dot login path, and here I can use that when I put the data, of course, here. And now you will ask how I'm going to use this service at all. So again, Angular loves dependency injection, so that is the thing that we're going to do right now. We're going to inject this service in our component where we have our form with the data, and we're going to pass the data as the argument of this login function called from the service, okay? So the first step here is to go to login component.ts, and here we have a function called login. Here for now this is just a console log from our login form. We don't need this anymore, so right now I'm going to call my service. The first step here is to inject it through the constructor. So I'm going to say that I'm going to use private, let's say out service of type of type auth service. Okay, so it is important, as you can see here from the top, private, I have misspelled that, and here I can use that. This dot auth service, as you can see here, if I put dot, we're seeing this method login from our service. So I'm going to use that login, and here, as you can see, my TypeScript is saying that expected one argument but zero were given. So I'm going to say that my argument is in my this dot login form dot value, right? Because as you remember earlier, I have console log this, and there we were seeing that there is username with the value from the input and the password from the with the value from the input. Okay, so this is the thing. But here is the interesting part, because this is an observable and we are waiting for result. Here we can not say then as for the promises, but here we can say subscribe because it is an observable. And here we are waiting for some data. We don't know exactly what date is this, but we are going to say console log and we're going to see what is the date. Or we can see it directly in the network. Remember, if you don't subscribe to this, the data will not come. So always subscribe to your observables. Okay, so the second step here is to build the logic for the register, which basically will be the same. Here I'm going to have another function which will be register function. Again, here I'm going to describe the parameter called data or whatever you want, and I'm going to say observable. This observable will be of type any, and of course here I'm going to put a return of this.http. Again, I'm going to use post because it is a post request, and I'm going to say a payload for it, and I'm going to say here another private variable which will be register path. Okay, so here, as you can see, we can go to this URL which will be register. And here I can specify this dot register path, of course, with this date. If I go to my register component, you can see that here we have another console log which is not needed, and here I can inject again the service. It is basically the same approach. I'm injecting the service and I'm using the function I need. So again, private auth service of type auth service. Okay, so we have a couple of minutes here and we're going to do the backend logic. So now we're going to do something like, again, we have to use this auth service dot obey. Okay, so I have misspelled this and I'm going to remove this because it's not so appropriate. So now I'm going to say auth service dot what. So here, as you can see, I don't get IntelliSense. The main reason why is because this is not important. So if I go and import this, now if I say dot, I have IntelliSense. So I'm going to say register, and after that I'm going to say this dot register form dot value. Okay, so the second step will be to make our front end work with our backend. For this purpose, we have to have URLs and we have to do this request. After we have done this, I'm going to show you how we can do the routing. Please don't forget to subscribe for this channel, and if you like this video and it was useful, you can like it and comment. Thanks, bye.